growing up in out in the country where our family was, it was a little hard to socialize, because there was the protecting wrestling. So if there was a wrestler at our house that was seen as a villain, what would he be doing at my dad's house? So we didn't have many people over at our house, many of my friends anyway. And I was very protective of anyone that knocked it at school. I didn't want to ever be friends with them, so they weren't allowed to come up to my house. I didn't care if I wasn't popular, because I kind of X'd off about 95% of anyone that I met, because they just made one little remark about wrestling. I wouldn't do that to them. I wouldn't say, oh, your dad's a cop, he's tickets, and he's what, you know, I wouldn't say that, or I wouldn't knock people like that. I just don't know why they would do that, but they were relentless year after year. So you just become more close to your brothers and sisters, and the ones that do make it into the group, I'm still friends with them. I had a best friend who lived nearby. She was about 7 years younger, and I was very close with her. And another friend that I met in grade 10 at a wrestling show that they were putting on to raise money for the school. Despite that, the coach that was the referee for that is knocking it. He's the coach. He was refereeing the match. It was JYD against Al Leilani. My dad is here raising money for my high school, and Dynamite and Bruce had just come in from Japan the night before, like at 1 a.m, and then we're at the school doing it for Friday to do this. It was like less than 12 hours later, they're wrestling, and then they're going to wrestle that night. But anyway, my brother Bruce went to hit John Foley with a chair, which maybe shouldn't have been happening at a high school show, I don't know. But he went to hit John Foley with a metal chair, and John tipped his head, because it isn't acting, and it isn't, nothing is, just Bruce just grabbed the chair and went to hit him, and caught John right here, instead of maybe on top of his head. His head just burst open. You know, I was such a fan of Dynamite's and of Bruce's. I hadn't met Davey yet, but I was staying afterwards to just to talk to him. I had quite a crush on him, actually. I couldn't tell anyone that, because wouldn't have been allowed in my family, because you don't know with wrestlers what may become of them if they're going to be there for, just to get to the point of this. I got back to the classroom. It was an English class, and we were supposed to write on Fridays. I didn't like the teacher at all. So she just was always, she never gave me good marks, and you know, I didn't get my mom to help me, and my mom was a genius. She really was. She had a genius IQ and gifted writer, and I'd even get her to help me with things, and the teacher would give me a C, you know, C minus. And you know, I was like, what? She just didn't like me, and I had her for 3 damn years. But anyway, I get to the classroom, and she's sort of sitting and lamenting that with her leg rocking about maybe what a joke the show was or something, I don't know. But when I got in, I could tell there was like a buzz going on in the room, and there was this girl arguing with these people about wrestling. And she said, well, I don't know, I think that was real blood, and I think he really did hit him. And they were like, no, are you kidding? Are you stupid? And, you know, and I was like, this girl, she didn't even know me, and she was sticking up for it. And I had another friend in that classroom, and she was kind of arguing against, you know, telling this girl that she was wrong too. And I looked at my friend, who, you know, was my friend, like, you're a traitor in a way. And then I looked at the other girl, and I'm still friends with her now. Her name's Allison. She never ever knocked wrestling.
How difficult was it to be a teenage girl in the Hart family?
It was kind of awkward. I didn't have any dates. I did have a couple of, well, I shouldn't say I didn't have any, but I had one guy that I, one boy I liked a lot, but we went out for pizza and there were some of his friends there, and they're like, oh, so you're one of the Harts, and that's all fake, right? And then as soon as I hear that, it's like, okay, I can't, this will never go anywhere. So, but when I met Davey and he was my age and he was so impressive, he fit right in to, I was 17 and he was 18, and I just felt like, finally I've got someone that understands wrestling, that he's so good looking too. So he's just, to me, he was just, you know, he was just everything. So anything that I may have missed out on, didn't really matter. At the end of the day, it didn't really matter. I wanted him to grow his hair out because he had beautiful curly hair, and he would shave it or he'd grow it out about a little bit. And he was not with the Dynamite Kid anymore, and I wanted him to do something really different to make him stand apart from that old image. He still had that. Didn't want him to change much about himself, but just, I said, just try to grow your hair out. Just, I was relentless about it. And he's like, well, I can't, it aggravates me. And that's what I said, well, would you ever try braiding it? Like, and anyway, he had a kind of a mullet, I guess, because it was short up here and he was trying to grow it down here. And eventually he did grow it out. It took a few years to get the whole where you could braid it right from the scalp up here. But for a while he was just braiding this. And then I put red, white, and blue beads in it for Union Jack, and really accentuate that British, your British heritage. And we're trying to give him something totally different. I worked on him for a long time to wear just trunks. He said, oh, I hate me legs. I don't like me legs. He loved training, and he finally just worked out with enough people that said, you're pretty strong. You should really train your legs more, because you can put on a lot of size if you train your legs. So he did, and that, you know, getting the stronger legs, it just sort of carried on. His upper body got stronger, and he was squatting more. The squatting, I think, helped his back, although up to a point. And then when his back got really bad, then, you know, it was too much to put that weight on it. But I think the squatting helped him withstand a lot of the bumps that he took, because he put everything into it, you know, doing a turnbuckle and stuff. He'd really fly into it. You know, I think that was something that he and Dynamite and Bret all, put themselves into, you know, when they hit the ropes and stuff there. But anyway, yeah, that was my idea, though. That was my idea. But yeah, the braids was the red, white, and blue, and later on he could part them on the side when he, but poor guy, though, you know, when he get, poor Davey, when he get them in, because he'd want them to last as long as he could, she would do it so tight, and it was just like, and I know when I have my hair in a clip up here or a ponytail, it hurts when you take it out, or you get almost a headache. It's like someone pulling your hair. You see little babies with a really tight little thing. It's like, oh, that must hurt. They don't even know, but just that little tight ponytail. So I, you know, he'd go through that about, oh, and then one time he's wrestling Mr. Perfect, and the braid wrapped around the rope and it ripped right out of his head. It was just, and he had like a little bald patch there for a while, but it was bleeding. It didn't like, it was just like when you skin your leg so bad it goes almost to the muscle. Like it wasn't like, it was just a, almost looked like orange peel juice. Like the, when you rub an orange peel, it almost looks oily. Anyway, that was a, I don't remember who gave him the braid back. I think the referee did.
Thank you.
I think at the time he was just disgusted with what they did to Bret, and you know, he was very close to Bret. It was like breaking up with your girlfriend that you really like, but she's crossed the line, and then you get with a new girlfriend and she's a complete ass. I know my dad said, you know, just cool heads will prevail, and I think he... I don't think my dad ever wanted Bret to leave WWF, and I don't know that Bret ever did want to leave either, but they must have known when they did that to Bret that there was going to be the potential for a mass exodus. Rick Rude left, and Jim, well, Jim was sort of not, he wasn't quite under contract with either, but they must have known that this was, so why did they want to get, why did they want to sacrifice that? The potential of that happening was, you know, we're gonna screw Bret badly, you know, and, you know, do that to his dad. And also, I mean, it hurt my dad too, and my mom. Like, I just don't understand why they had to do that to him. You know, it's all water under the bridge now, but, you know, that was very wrong, what they did. And Owen was disgusted, and he almost left, but I think he thought maybe it won't last in WCW and they're going to come back, and which was the case with Davey. And I know that Bret maybe realized once he was there, even though he was in the main event position, he maybe wasn't understood the way you know, Vince had understood him and built up his character. You know, it was you know, it wasn't just one person that did it. But you know, Vince and Bret had a pretty good relationship. I think Vince was like a father figure to my dad, or to Bret, in a different way than my dad. But it was very disturbing that he felt he needed to do that to Bret, even though that when they were the ones that sort of initiated him to leave, they said, we can't pay you this contract that we signed you for. We can't do it, but we'll give you an open door to leave if you want to go to WCW. And I think Bret was kind of like in a marriage, like, you know, like, we've had 15 really good years, but our company's not, you know, my business isn't going well, so you're welcome to divorce me and, you know, find someone else. It's just like, well, no, I wasn't planning on divorcing anyone. Like, I think Bret thought, well, I'll stay and help you get your business going again, or whatever. It was apparently financial problems they were having, but they didn't seem to want to work anything out. And I don't think it was Bret. I think they didn't want to work anything out. And Bret's not a sap either. He didn't want to just be, you know, well, okay, I'll wrestle for free or to help you. He wasn't, he's just like, okay, well, work out something, see if WCW will help me out. And they gave Bret this huge contract, and so Bret was like, all right, I'm on a new journey. But, you know, at the end of it all, it was like, well, we just didn't know if you were going to bury us on TV, throw the belt in the garbage or something, and then move on to... So it's like, okay, well, that's what you think Bret would have done. You didn't know him very well. You know, it was a very hard decision, though. He could have stayed with Owen, who he was very close to, or he could have gone with... Well, he did go with Bret. But, yeah, it was... And then he regretted it almost as soon as he got there, unfortunately. That was really hard on him. I know you're not supposed to believe your own press and stuff, but that was really hard on him to be this... like a big, beautiful Percheron horse, and you get put in with a bunch of, you know, nasty zebras or something that can't, you know, that aren't even nice to you. And then he's getting hurt by guys that, you know, he did get badly hurt. He had had injuries for sure. You know, he just had injuries before I ever met him that all, you know, domino effect into when he broke his back, you know, he had taken his share of painkillers in his day too, and he was, but that, you know, it was the straw that broke, literally, you know, the straw that broke the camel's back was when he got slammed on that trap door that they never told him about was, and the where the break was in his back, I don't understand how it worked, but it, or how it, but it got infected, and he had a, and his pain was, and he did go into a rehab for it, and it was just unfortunate that then just so many mental things. He, you get to an age where you can't be what you're not, you can't be what you were. It's hard. Like I know, in a way, I know why Ric Flair never quite walks away from it, and Terry Funk, like, maybe they are in excruciating pain, and they, you know, I saw some documentary with Terry's taping his knees up, and you know, that was, you know, 15 years ago maybe, but, and then all of these things like the Von Erichs with, they all wrestled, and they, you know, even after losing brother after brother after brother, they still, you know, they still kept at it. Like, that was, it's just such a different breed. Feel protective of it, and if people don't I just, for example, saw a couple of weeks ago a match that was at the WrestleMania. I was watching it. I haven't watched a WrestleMania in a while. My brother Bruce, I hadn't seen him in a while, and we got together for this WrestleMania, and there was a few people in the room. And they're wrestling fans, but, and I know they felt comfortable enough to talk about it, but it's, one of them was, I was saying making remarks just to Bruce about something, like, oh, anything like, what time are they at now, or, nothing, knocking wrestling, but I think the group we were with felt they could be more liberal with their comments. And when Shane jumped off the cage, he climbed up like a cat, and you know, that in itself was pretty impressive. It's a pretty high cage, and he's already been through a big match, and Undertaker's nearly 50, and he's out there doing his, you know, doing his best, and so Shane jumps down, and Undertaker moves, and few of these people were saying how that was so fake, and I said, what the hell are you talking about? He just jumped about 30 feet onto a table. And then he said, well, the table broke his fall. It's like, oh, okay. Well, you'd give that a try and let me know how that works for you, because I don't know how that is fake. And, you know, that's a physical aspect, but when they say it's, they read scripts, well, in my day, they, not like my day, I never wrestled, but in my generation of it, my family's promotion and what I saw, I never saw anyone have a script, ever. I never, so when someone says it's all scripted, it's still, I bristle about that, because it isn't, in my opinion, it isn't scripted. Harry, my son, doesn't follow a script, but I know there, it's a different day and age apparently now, so I don't know that it'll ever be the way it was. I don't know if it's too far gone that, getting back to it, yes, I appreciate you saying that I put wrestling first, because I do, it's like my family, and when people knock it, it's like they're knocking my family, and my father had such a decent territory from around 1952 to 1988, and even after that, he still tried to mentor people, and he always wanted them to succeed, and he didn't want anything for it. He just wanted them to do well, and he was just such a decent person. And for my mom and dad to run this such an influential territory out of their house with the 12 kids through thick and thin, like really thin times sometimes for maybe 10 years where it's just, but he still kept it going, and he knew he had to look after the wrestlers that, and their families. And when people will say things about my particular like Stampede Wrestling or my family or Bret or Davey, or I just get so very defensive about it. And I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for, well, certainly not for my mom and dad. But I wouldn't be here if I wasn't Davey's wife and wasn't a part of the SummerSlam, which was Bret and Davey. And that match was such a, I'm so glad it was filmed, and the whole thing that was like over 80,000 people. And I was only there because I was Davey's wife and Bret's sister, and it works to have me in the middle. I think that was something great that I was a part of, and then I got to be part of other things later on. And now my son, and I feel he's carrying on what my father and his father would have liked to see happen in wrestling. I mean, progress, you can't keep living in, with a covered wagon, but I don't think my dad's wrestling was a covered wagon. As you know, I know technology changes. I just don't get where it's going now. I just don't get it. When I was growing up, I wasn't really allowed to watch my dad wrestle, so not live. And the odd time I saw him wrestling on TV, I would get so upset. It was just so like they're hurting my dad. So I guess they just figured it wasn't good for me to watch it, it was almost like I was being traumatized. But I remember wrestling Abdullah the Butcher and Archie Goldie, two different things, but I had never seen my dad. We had him in the interview on TV, on this little black and white TV. He's got it's blood even though it's black and white, but coming through this white thing tied around his head, and I'm looking at him in the chair next to me, and he's got band-aids on his head, and I was just, it's like, ah. And then you go to school and have little anemic bullies, that would blow down on a windy day, telling me that my dad's a fake, or their dad could beat my dad, and I'm really proud of Harry, Davey Boy Smith Jr., and a couple of weeks ago they wrestled in Calgary, and it wasn't really a big crowd, or it was a fundraiser, the first one, but I was so anxious for them, Harry, Davey Boy Smith Jr., to wrestle my nephew Ted, Teddy Hart, because in a live crowd, even if there was just 75 people there, because I wanted it documented, and they did film it, because I want that to be what people see, is the third generation of wrestling, not what they may have seen Harry do in WWE when he was D.H. Smith. His wrestling was great there, but he didn't even have, they didn't even let him do much there. A 3-minute match, and changing his image from heel, bad guy to good guy to bad guy to good guy on a almost like a monthly basis, and changing his costume, and they just never let him get any traction there. I'm pissed off about that. It really bothers me, because Harry's a pedigree, he's the cream of the crop, and his pedigree, Stu Hart's grandson and Davey's son, and he's not just some little 5'8" agent's son that's taking some enhancing things, and going bald, and hoping, you know, getting a push. Like Harry trained for years with Billy Robinson, and he trained with Tokyo Joe in Calgary with TJ, and for years just to get just one chance in New Japan, and then he is such a good wrestler, and you know, whatever they want to say, that he didn't have a character, he couldn't wasn't good on the mic. It's like, you changed his persona every week, how would he know what he's supposed to do? But Harry does these amazing impersonations, so it's like, well, Harry can imitate anything. He can imitate a cat with hairball. Like, he can do anything. He's gifted. You know, some people are really Robin Williams. Like, they can just... Harry's like that, so... I say, well, I don't know what you didn't see, but... I think my brothers and sisters and I are close. We don't have... I haven't spoken to Martha in a long time, Owen's widow, and nor have I seen her kids, but that's just, I guess that's just the way it goes there. She doesn't want them being around anything to do with wrestling, so, but my brothers and sisters, you know, we went through some ups and downs, particularly after Owen died, and, but my immediate, you know, the actual, my siblings, there's 10 of us left now. I think that we're close. I think after the 2010 Hall of Fame, when my dad was inducted in the WWE Hall of Fame, we all were brought up on stage, and we were put into some storyline the next day that none of us knew about. It was funny because my sister Allison is so, never been in a wrestling ring in her life. I don't think she'd ever been in a ring in her life, but she was in there, you know, right in there at the end. But it was really nice. It was a definite thawing for all of us, and it was good to see when Bret was inducted in, I think it was 2006, we weren't all invited, and I know their Hall of Fames weren't as magnanimous as they are now. I guess, you know, it was gigantic, so they brought down my son Harry and my nephew Ted. There were two people, and then Bret had some of his own family there, so I wasn't at Bret's induction, and so when my dad was inducted, it was really the first time I'd been a part of any of that, so it was an unforgettable experience. I'm so glad, and it's just so nice to be around everybody. And but I find I haven't been around, I haven't been to the Cauliflower Alley convention since 2000 when my dad was inducted. And then when getting back to why I wrote the book, and I felt like a void was needing to be filled and missing wrestling, I kind of been out of touch. I went back to school and, you know, was writing this book and just sort of licking my wounds in an unnatural way, I guess, off in some corner. I came down here to sell my book because it's called Cauliflower Heart. And no idea what was going to happen. I just figured I'd be at a table for, 5 o'clock or when it was finished. I think I'm in a 9-to-5 mindset. I would go to my room and I'd probably just try to get on the internet, because my phone hasn't been working here. But when I was leaving, I thought I'll start working on my computer, my laptop, and do more writing, and because I have a couple of other books I've started in fiction about wrestling. And but I didn't do that at all. I was talking with people, all like how I met you, and met people that I saw people I haven't seen in years, and I met people I never met before, and I just feel like it was such a good thing to do this. And it ends up that it wasn't even about selling my book. I still have 3 boxes of books to take back to Calgary, but I would take back 50 boxes of books to Calgary if it you know, to have had this experience. It's just unforgettable. It's really hard to explain that when you get into a 9-to-5 situation or outside of wrestling, and people just don't get what you're missing or what you grew up with. You know, it's not. I don't think a lot. In some cases, I think they just don't know. Maybe they just didn't follow wrestling. Maybe they followed golf or something. But they just don't get it. And then you come to something like the Cauliflower Alley convention, or you're talking on Facebook to people, and they like the anniversary of just little things like my mom's birthday, or something even more. I guess tragic, like Owen's death, but on a day like that, I could be a little bit emotional, and I'll run into somebody, you know, right after I've put my phone away, and they don't understand, and they'll even be a bit cruel about it, like, well, you need to get over this. It's like, no, but you don't understand, it was just such a beautiful message. I'm not trying to be a martyr. It's just, you know, someone will write a poem that, you know, and I know how difficult it is to write, so to write a poem about, you know, what my mom and dad meant to them is a beautiful thing, and I get emotional about it. So, you know, some people are like, you need to get over this. I don't know if I'm over anything, but I'm not. It's not like I'm wearing Davey's gear to work or that I, you know, but it will always get to me. If the day ever comes where I'm so jaded that I can't feel touched by the wrestling fans that care about my family, I'll be ashamed of myself. It's a sort of a wrestling suspense love story, a little bit sultry, not gender specific. I think it works for male or female if the males get past the romance, which I think is universal no matter what animal you are or what gender you are. But I was very lonely for wrestling. It was around 2011 when I really tucked into this. I was always a big journaler, but I got lonely for it when Harry, my son Harry, Davey Boy Smith Jr., departed from WWE and pursued his dream in Japan, where he had been wrestling before, before he went there, about 2005 and 6, 7. Anyway, I just couldn't find anything to fill the void. I was in Tampa, Florida, missing my family. I'd been in Florida from about 08 to 2013, but just didn't feel like I fit in anywhere, and I was very depressed, and I started writing just little things about, not necessarily about me, but about what I saw growing up, or just saw in life, and sometimes turned it into a wrestling thing. Maybe it was something I saw in a policeman's daughter's life or something, but it kind of, but basically it's wrestling. I think that's, I feel like I'm a credible source. I like to think that I am, to be writing about wrestling. I feel, maybe I have some right to do that versus someone who, you know, just, you know, came off the street, sort of. I don't know how to say that without sounding like I'm offending anyone that's written books about wrestling that isn't in wrestling, but this is fiction. Just because the protagonist has blonde hair and the in cauliflower heart doesn't mean it's me. Just because, you know, the protagonist has a husband who's a wrestler doesn't mean it's Davey either. But I did draw a lot from everything in my life to create this. It's a trilogy, and I'm really proud of it. So I did a book in 2001 that I was pretty much ostracized for. It was an autobiography, and I wasn't happy with how it came out and how it turned out. You know, I just think it was, I wouldn't say it was poorly planned, but it was a huge disappointment for me, and I think I hurt a lot of people in what I said, but it wasn't what I was trying to say. So just, you know, when I wrote this, it was so therapeutic to write, and I wrote for about 5 years, but when I started making it into fiction, that started around 2011. So, yeah, it was, I don't want to say a journey for me, it's so overused, and it was very cathartic for me to do this, because I got a lot of things off my chest, and the most affection I have in the book is where I'm talking about the love that this family has for each other and their animals and kids and stuff. But it does take place in a wrestling world. There's a really touching relationship between the protagonist's brother and her husband. You don't have to be a wrestling fan to appreciate the story, but there is a murder in it, so there's a suspense there. So, yeah, it's available on officialdianahart.com.